When Carly Nuttall was born in Tucson in 2007, her heart was barely functioning. Doctors pulled her parents aside and gave them the grim news.
They said, you know, that her heart was in such bad shape that they didn't expect her to live through the night.
Somehow, Carly Nuttall survived that night, and she hung on for the next 2 weeks, but it was touch and go. Then, Carly got a Berlin heart. It's the only FDA-approved cardiac pump for young children. Doctors told her parents it would hopefully keep Carly alive until they could find a donated heart.
So that was the plan, is get the Berlin heart on, let her grow and get bigger, and then hopefully a heart would become available for a heart transplant.
Off, let me make sure I clamped it.
After 5 days, doctors dialed back the device. They wanted to see how Carly's own heart would respond.
After 15 days, they were able to dial it all the way down to zero, and her heart was doing the work it needed to do. So they were able to take the Berlin heart off, and now she still has her own heart, and we are just very grateful.
Cardiac surgeon Jack Copeland hooked Carly up to the device. She was the youngest child to ever get one. Dr. Copeland says a Berlin heart is often the only thing standing between life and death for children with damaged hearts. But he says Carly was lucky because the device can cause severe complications.
It causes clots. And the stroke rate with these kids, that is the percent of kids that get strokes, has been anywhere from about 25% up to 100%. So that's a pretty high rate, and that's unacceptable really by anybody's standard, and everybody's upset about that. But it's, I think that's where we are right now.
Allison Marsden hopes to change that. She's an assistant professor of mechanical and aerospace engineering. Marsden became interested in medical devices during her postdoctoral training at Stanford.
I think the issues of sort of how blood flow, the patterns of blood flow in surgeries and devices are really interesting from an engineering point of view, but also I enjoy working on those problems because of their immediate application to sort of human problems and patient care.
The Berlin heart looks like a simple device. Marsden says what happens inside of it is complicated.
So this device is made up of two chambers. There's a blood chamber on the top, there's an air chamber down here, and there's a rather thin membrane that divides the two chambers. And so when the bottom chamber is pressurized, the membrane goes up and down. But its motion is nonlinear, so meaning that it buckles in a complex pattern.
Marsden hopes she can eventually discover how the flow patterns inside the Berlin heart relate to the risk of blood clots. Then she might be able to suggest some design changes. But first, she's been trying to develop a computer model of the Berlin heart.
Hey, Allison.
Hey, so how's it going?
Marsden and graduate student Chris Long have been working to simulate the interplay between blood, air, and the complex membrane motion. Talk about challenging. At each of nearly 2 million points inside the device, they have to calculate three components of velocity and pressure. The mathematical equations to come up with the simulations are extremely complex. As a matter of fact, researchers had to use the power of some supercomputers here on the UC San Diego campus. Structural engineer Yuri Bozilevs is working with Marsden on the Berlin heart simulations. He shares her fascination with figuring out how to improve medical devices. Bozilevs says you can't just pull software off the shelf to simulate the interactions inside the Berlin heart on a computer.
The current sort of state-of-the-art in commercial codes is that such problems are, I would say, nearly impossible or impossible to do.
So Bozilevs has had to use his knowledge of complex mathematics and computer science to come up with some custom applications.
So basically, I'm taking the methods that I've developed for cardiovascular blood flow, as well as things like surface ships or wind turbines, and we're applying it to this very interesting and challenging problem.
After 2 years of working on the simulations, here's what Bozilevs, Marsden, and Long have come up with, a computer model of the Berlin heart.
Basically, colors indicate how fast the flow is moving. And on the bottom here is the air chamber, on the top is the blood chamber, and this motion that you're seeing is this membrane that goes up and down. And you can see that it has a very complex buckling motion, which is something that was quite challenging to capture in the simulation. And what we're interested now is to analyze the flow field to really pick out What are the areas of high risk in terms of blood clot formations?
Dr. Copeland welcomes these efforts, but he's skeptical about whether artificial heart pumps can be substantially improved. He believes doctors have to do a better job of treating pediatric heart disease.
What our job is really to figure out the biology of what's going on and try to treat it with the appropriate medications so that further iterations of devices are welcome. But in the meantime, we've got to serve the population that needs these devices by optimizing the way we treat them to minimize the amount of strokes that they have.